This is Guerrillero Heroico, one of the most iconic photographs of the 20th century. Taken by Alberto Korda in 1960, it quickly spread across social movements across the globe. Looking at the image, it's not hard to see why it captured the hearts of so many people. Here's an attractive, rugged, determined revolutionary, ripped from context and space so that it appeals to anyone with a vision for a better world. And the story of the real Che Guevara really lives up to the art. Being one of the founding fighters behind the Cuban Revolution, after overthrowing the Batista regime, he decided to leave his government post behind and fight with revolutionaries across the world. He had accomplished everything he wanted and decided to leave it all behind anyway. The Eternal Revolutionary ended up dying at the hands of the Bolivian army in the thick of the Bolivian jungle. His response to his captors echoed through time.
Sé que vienes a matarme. Dispara, cobarde, que solamente vas a matar a un hombre.
This is the short romantic history of Che Guevara that's known in popular culture. But his sworn comrade and confidant, Fidel Castro, hardly gets the same affection. Both men fought valiantly, overthrew an oppressive regime, and changed the fate of the world forever. But outside of Chicano communities, the popular appeal of Fidel is limited. And even among radicals, many criticize Fidel for the shortcomings of the Cuban government. Putting aside any real criticisms we might have of the two revolutionaries, this dichotomy of legacy is a part of a wider problem. We love revolutionaries, but only when they're martyrs. Jones Manuel is a historian and a member of the Partido Comunista Brasileiro, and he believes that this dichotomy has a lot to do with the influence of Christianity on Western culture. And if my audience statistics are correct, and you're a 20 to 30 something male living in the United States, you probably don't think Christianity or the Catholic Church would ever have an influence in your way of thinking, but Manuel would disagree. The Catholic Church is the longest operating institution in the West. No other institution has managed to stay alive for so long with a capacity to disseminate and circulate ideas and concepts through a body of intellectual priests, bishops, and theologians organized within a bureaucracy like the Catholic Church has. So it's impossible to speak seriously about Marxism, politics, subjectivity, culture, and the symbolic field in the West without incorporating the role of Christianity in each social formation, in each specific country as elements of analysis. Christianity forms the structure upon which culture in the United States is built upon. It influences the tales we tell about ourselves and others. Even if as individuals we're not Christian, it's an ever-present force, just like Confucianism in China and Islam in Africa. Now, I wouldn't be the first to draw parallels between Jesus Christ and Che Guevara, but it's a comparison worth noting. We love Che because, on some level, he's a secular Jesus Christ. He's so powerful as a symbol because he died a saintly death. Meanwhile, Fidel's an old bureaucrat, and this doesn't provide the same visceral feelings of affection. But don't let that fool you. Fidel's Cuba is what Che was fighting for, and every single stumbling block, every bad decision, and every error are part of the same legacy. As much as many would like to, there is no separating them. They're the same struggle. Many people might disagree and say, well, Fidel betrayed the ideals of the revolution. If they're socialists, they'll probably point to the mistakes as examples of how what he was doing wasn't real socialism. And I understand why people do this, but Manuel would argue that it's another facet of Christian influence on Western thinkers. Like a theologian trying to explain away the blood-stained past of Christianity, they'll argue that the doctrine is one of compassion and love for one another. Sure, the church might have worked with dictators and fascists, enabled widespread suffering and abuse, but hey, those were misapplications of the Holy Gospel. Manuel writes that there is a constant throughout the entire history of Christianity, which is that these elements don't corrupt the doctrine. They are either false expressions of Christianity, or they're just facts, like potatoes in a sack, that have no theoretical, political, or most importantly, theological meaning. According to some people, it seems like every time the dust of the revolution settles, the new government, the new institutions, and the new leaders betray the doctrine. Therefore, nothing is socialism and everything is state capitalism. Nothing is socialist transition and everything is state capitalism. The revolution is only a revolution during that glorious moment of taking political power. Starting from the moment of building a new social order, it's over. This is a problem, because the destruction of an existing social order only constitutes half of a revolution, and the other half is building something new. Without critically engaging with what happened in that second half, and instead just disowning its legacy, we fail to understand the revolution and the people involved entirely. But this only explains one facet of the problem. Inherent with our love for martyrs, we also romanticize failure and poverty. Manuel highlights the discrepancy in treatment between Palestine and North Korea. Both countries fought similar struggles and ended up decimated by imperialism. In the case of North Korea, the country lost around 15% of its population in the Korean War, with the US bombings leaving the country a desolate wasteland. Don't believe me? In 1951, Senator John C. Stennis stated,
"Oh yes, I would say that almost the entire Korean Peninsula is just a terrible mess. Everything is destroyed, and there is nothing standing worthy of the name."
Meanwhile, Palestine has been described as an open-air prison, with Israel openly committing genocide upon the Palestinian people. But look at the differences between how the two are treated. Korea is not a defenseless nation. Palestinians are a people who are deeply oppressed in a situation of extreme poverty. Therefore, Palestine is the total incarnation of the metaphor of David versus Goliath, except that this David doesn't have a chance of beating Goliath in political and military conflict. Therefore, almost everyone in the international left likes Palestine. People become ecstatic looking at those images, which I don't think are very fantastic, of a child or a teenager using a sling to launch a rock at a tank. Look, this is a clear example of heroism, but it is also a symbol of barbarism. This is a people who do not have the capacity to defend themselves facing an imperialist colonial power that is armed to the teeth. They do not have an equal capacity of resistance, but this is romanticized. Western leftists like the situation of oppression, suffering, and martyrdom. Meanwhile, North Korean people are not treated with any sympathy over their struggle against imperialism. When talking about North Korea, the story never starts with the United States decimating the country, with North Koreans living paranoid and fearful of US bombings for over 3 years. Progressives like John Oliver, who are the supposed voice of the left, hardly even bring it up. But since they weren't beaten into the dust, and instead stood up and built a nation that could contend with these global superpowers, they're suddenly not worthy of consideration. Not worthy of critical support against an imperialist force that wants to wipe them off the face of the planet. Finally, I'm going to quote Manuel one final time, because he's a damn good writer and says this all way better than I ever could. "The idealization of Che and dismissal of Fidel is a microcosm for the larger idealization of eternal resistance. When Bernie Sanders lost the Democratic primary for the second time, a renowned Marxist professor at the University of Sao Paulo posted on Facebook, 'We fought like never before. We lost as usual, but the fight continues.' Now, Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez is the future of socialism in the United States." The Marxist logic of thinking of all political conflicts in terms of strategy, tactics, coalition politics, programs, of critically analyzing mistakes to avoid making them again, of hitting the enemy from a political or even military standpoint in order to take power, has simply vanished, replaced by an eternal movement of resistance, as if it were proof of divine grace. The very logic that should be the essence of politics, which is the logic of strategy, is devalued as resistance becomes an end to itself. This explains why the image of Che, the eternal revolutionary, is so popular. For the past 50 years, that's all movements have aspired to be, an eternal resistance. And in that light, the guerrillero heroico takes on a corrupted meaning. It's no longer an image of representing brave revolutionaries. It stands as a symbol of left complacency, a resistance too fearful to take risks, build power, and meaningfully challenge the status quo. No wonder it's been co-opted and plastered on anything you can imagine. Maybe next time I'll print Fidel stickers instead of Che ones. Now, if you made it this far, I don't want you to think I'm apologizing for atrocities or supporting men like Fidel, Kim Jong-un, or anyone else in everything they've done. But they're just that, men, individuals who had to navigate the turbulent waters of being the figurehead of a movement and then nation of a million conflicting interests, trying to build a new world surrounded by forces that antagonize them at every single turn. And just like Fidel and Che were engaged in the same struggle, if you're anti-imperialist, you're engaged in the same common struggle as authoritarian leaders like Nicolas Maduro of Venezuela or of the Vietnamese Republic. We can critically examine the mistakes of a hereditary monarchy like that of North Korea, we can find that we don't agree with the policies of countries like China, and we can vow to do better than past generations of revolutionaries. But we have to engage critically with the work of movements who have come before us. Because once we start dismissing these struggles without any other thought, then we might as well stop calling ourselves leftists. Anyway, that's the video. I printed out stickers that I'm giving out to anyone who's ever supported the channel with a donation. They'll be going out in the next few weeks, but I'm waiting to get a good headcount before I print them. So please, please, please contact me on Twitter or email if you've ever donated, and I'll get them to you right away. Peace.